these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Let us pray. O Father, our hearts will sing to you today because of your great love. Love that is rich and pure. Love that is beyond compare. Love that leads us when we are in the wilderness, when we are in the barren place. Love that leads us to the blessing and to the warmth of your embrace. We ask today, O God, as we sing together, as we read your word, as we reflect again and again upon your Son, the Lord Jesus, we would once again be in awe and in wonder at that love. Love that we don't deserve, love that we have done nothing to merit, but love that is assured to us and for us in and through the work of your Son. So, Father, we are sorry for all the things that we think and do and say, all the things that we leave undone that do not honor that great love that there is for us in Christ. We're sorry for all the things that get in the way, all the things that so easily distract us from our focus upon Him and how we fill up our lives with all of this stuff that only lasts for a season and only gives short-term pleasure instead of reflecting again and again upon the joy that there is in your precious Son. So in His name, Father, forgive us, inspire us, and lead us and guide us so that we may worship you in spirit and in truth, and that this would be a time for us to set aside those things that are in the way and to look to Him again. We pray as we normally do, using the words that He gave to His friends when they asked Him, how do we pray? We say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Is that the hymn number? Four, one, seven. We try to be really subtle there, John, and not let away that we were trying to communicate with each other. So let's drop the pretense. Right, so we're going to sing 417, and the verses are 1, 2, 6, and 7. 1, 2, 6, and 7. So let's stand together and worship with 417 and those selected verses.
Thank you.
Boys and girls, could I invite you to come up to the front to see me? And this time round, if you could come and sit over this side for me this morning, just over here, that would be really helpful. Thank you very much. Brilliant. Have a wee seat there a second, guys. All right. So we'll just need to leave this side clear this morning, because you're going to see why in a wee minute, all right? So, well, good morning. You all right? It's good to see you today. And I wanted to ask you to have a wee look here behind me and see that there's something set up in the church that's not normally set up in the church every Sunday morning. Does anybody know what this is? What the word for it is? No. This is called a font. It's called a baptismal font. And inside there's some water. And in a few minutes, you're going to see me using the font in a very, very special way. So what we do in the church is when a wee baby is born and when their mummy or their daddy or both their mummy and daddy love Jesus and follow Jesus and want their wee baby to do the same thing, they bring their baby to church and we put some water on the baby's head and we pray that that wee baby would grow up and follow Jesus and love him. And that's what we're going to do in a wee minute. Why do you think we use water to do that? Any idea? No? Well, what did Jesus do when he died on the cross? He washed away our sin. He died on the cross and he washed away our sin. And that's what the water symbolizes. When you get washed with water, don't you? Isn't that right? So the water that we use is a symbol that when we put our trust in Jesus, he would wash away our sin. And we're going to pray that when we have a wee baby brought forward for baptism, that he or she would grow up and trust in Jesus and know that if they trusted in him, Jesus would wash away their sin as well. And there's loads more to it, but that's the gist. That's the important bit, that the wee baby that comes forward would know Jesus when they grow up and know that he would wash away their sin and that that promise is for them. So, what we're going to do is we're going to sing together, and then while we're singing, I'm going to ask Rebecca and Thomas and Daniel and Arthur to come up to the front, and then we're going to do this wee bit of the service together for the baptism. So, Thomas and Rebecca have chosen the hymn that we're about to sing for the baptism today. So you see it's number 374. So if you turn to it there, 374, what we're going to do is we're going to sing the first two verses now as we get prepared for the baptism. And then at the end of the baptism, then we'll sing the last two verses. So let's stand and lift our voices to God with hymn number 374, O God, Your Life-Creating Power, singing verses 1 and 2. Please be seated, friends. Guys, if you want, you can move up a wee bit so you can see what's going on if you want. You don't have to, but you can if you want. That's okay. All right. So, as I've already said, we are here today to, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, baptize Arthur. And this is not a magic ceremony. Nothing of a peculiar nature happens here. But what happens is that the faith that you share as a family is the faith that you would long for Arthur to grow up and to know himself. And we as a church family would pray that we would do all we can to support you as a whole family as you do this thing together. In the Old Testament, God gave to Abraham a sign of the covenant that the promise of God to him would be for him and his family and the generations that would follow. And that great promise would be something that would sustain him and his family and the community of faith down throughout the years. When Jesus came, Jesus brought that to completion, giving to us this covenant sign of water as a sign and a symbol of the promises of God. That those who would put their trust in Jesus would never be cast out or forgotten, never be forsaken, but would be God's children and would exist as that for all time. And as a community of faith, we are bound together by those promises. So as we baptize Arthur today, we, yes, want to focus upon him and the promises that there are for him, the promises there are for you as a family. But as a family of God, we are all reminded today at this baptism of the promises that there are for all of us as we share in this wonderful thing together. So Rebecca and Thomas have also chosen a couple of readings that would help us to think about this. And the first reading is from Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus. And this is what he says. He says this: "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord." There's two things there. The first part is boys and girls are meant to obey their parents. That doesn't always go to plan, but that's the idea. But it also means that mums and dads have a responsibility to teach their children the things of God. And those two responsibilities are together. And that's something you're going to promise to do today. And we have every confidence and faith in you that would indeed be the truth. Then another reading, this time from the Gospels, that talks of an event where Jesus was surrounded by children. And this is what happened. People were bringing little children to Jesus for him to place his hands on them. But the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. And he said to them, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." And he took the children in his arms, placed his hands on them, and blessed them. Now Jesus did not perform a baptism at that event, but what he did do was do two wonderful things. He showed that children should be at the center of the faith community and the church family. That children should be at the very core of it and accepted as part of it. And also, he showed the beautiful simplicity of a child's faith. A child who trusts in Jesus and that powerful example that we are meant to have. That when we get all grown up and sensible, we sometimes lose track of. So perhaps today, as Arthur is welcomed officially into our church family, we would recommit ourselves to be a church community that puts the children that belong to our church family at the center, but also be those who would follow their example in a simple, pure faith in their Savior. So we're going to come to the point now, Rebecca and Thomas, we're going to make some vows. These are the same vows that you made for this fine young man here. But you make them again, this time for Arthur. So I'm going to ask, along the lines of what we've already shared, this idea of you bringing up both your sons in the teaching of the church and sharing the faith that you have with them so that the promises that you know, they would know. So first of all, in presenting Arthur for baptism, do you profess your faith in God as your Creator and Father, in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and in the Holy Spirit as your sanctifier and guide. Lovely. And then secondly, will you, by God's help, provide a Christian home and bring up Arthur in the worship and teaching of the church so that he may come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior? Lovely. Thank you very much. As a congregation, we also have a responsibility to vow and promise that we would pray for this beautiful family and all the families of our church, that this would indeed be a place where children would grow in their knowledge and in their following of Christ. So in a moment, I'm going to ask you to show your willingness to do that by standing. But I'm going to pray first, and then at the end of the prayer, I'll ask you to stand to show your willingness to indeed do this thing. So let's pray. Father, as we come to bring Arthur for baptism, as a church family, we put our arms of love around this family standing at the front. We assure them of our prayers for them. We assure them, especially today, of our prayers for Arthur, that through the worship and teaching of this place, he would grow to know Jesus, that he would grow to be a mighty man of God. As a congregation, we thank you for the opportunity to be reminded today of the promises that there are for us in Jesus. Promise of sins forgiven, promise of life eternal, promise of a Holy Spirit who would walk with us all the days of our lives. As we are reminded of those things, we pray that you would bless us and that you would bless this family as they bask in these promises in these moments. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We show our willingness to do this thing by standing. I invite you to stand. I said to Rebecca and Thomas at the start of the service, I've only ever had one baby go mad. I've got quite a clean sheet, so Arthur, you're not going to let me down today, sure you're not? And we're going to do this thing together. So let's go. Oh, he's sound asleep. You're not going to thank me in a wee second. Sure you're not. Sure you're not. Arthur, Jesus came into this world. And into this world he brought a kingdom. A kingdom he brought for you, even though you don't quite know it just yet. But one day we pray you will grow up to know it, and you will follow him, and his love will well up within your heart to eternal life. So Arthur Isaac Clark, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And I pray his blessing upon you, now and indeed forevermore. Amen. I think we got away with that okay, Thomas, didn't we? Got him. Oh dear, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. Folks, we bless this family as we sing together the words of the Aaronautic blessing.
Thank you.
So as a congregation and church family, we'd like to present Arthur with this little Bible as a token of today, and of course it's inscribed on the inside what has happened today. So Arthur, you're not going to be able to read this yet, but maybe your mommy and daddy will read it to you, and then one day you can read it for yourself. So Daniel, am I going to give this to you to look after for your wee brother? No, okay, that's all right. Well, you'll maybe see it later on then. So folks, we're just going to pray one more time. Let's pray. Father, once again, we thank you for the privilege of sharing this special moment with this special family. And as we have shared in this moment, we have been reminded of many things. But one thing we ask is that you would bind us together in the bounds of love that there are for us in Christ. That as a church family, the promises and the faith that this sacrament displays, that would be a song in our hearts of Christ and his great love. So bind this family together ever closer in your love, and may they know health and strength and the good things of God, that they may be a family where that faith in Christ grows and grows. We ask it in his name. Amen. Amen. Folks, we're going to conclude this little part of the service with singing the remaining two verses of that hymn, number 374, verses 3 and 4. Folks, at this point in our service, boys and girls, if you want, you can head on out to Kids Zone, and in a moment or two then we'll continue our worship with the announcements. So please, folks, you can take your seats, and boys and girls, you can head out. Good morning, everyone. May I warmly welcome you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to this service of worship today, and pray that we would continue to know the Lord's leading and guiding as we worship him together. Just like to make some announcements, and you'll find them on our weekly news sheet. You're all very welcome and warmly invited to the coffee bar directly after the service today, which take place just in the Allen Hall. Please do stay for that time of fellowship after the service. Morning Watch will meet on Tuesday at 10:45 in the session room. Junior choir will resume practices on Tuesday from 6:30 to 7:15 p.m. in the Barber Hall. And all children aged 4 will be very, very welcome. And there's information there for contact in the news sheet. Kirk Session will meet on Tuesday at 7:45 in the session room. And the business committee are asked to meet at 7:15 prior to that in the minister's room. Evergreens will resume on Wednesday at 2:30 p.m. in the Allen Hall. You'll see information there that the speaker is Jackie Davey, talking about her book. And again, all are very, very warmly invited to that. The walking group will have their penultimate walk of the season on Saturday at 9:30 a.m., leaving the church grounds at that time for Woodburn Reservoir. Everyone is very welcome. Please speak to Robert if you would like any more information. Next Lord's Day, we gather at the normal time of 11 a.m. for our church family service. So our church family service is kind of a reimagining of our organization's dedication service. If you cast your minds back to that before COVID, where at the start of the church year, we had a service to dedicate the work of the church in that year to God. This is an attempt to do something of that kind of style, and that'll be next Lord's Day when we put to God, if you like, our hopes for the year ahead and all that we have planned, and ask for his blessing and encouragement as we would seek to serve him together. So that's next Sunday morning. And then a welcome return of the evening prayer and Bible study, which will take place next Lord's Day at 6:30 p.m., where we will look together at the letter to the Hebrews. So that's next Sunday evening. You'll also see some information there from Emmanuel Ministries in Calcutta, and there is a extract from an email recently received, and I would ask you to read that and to dedicate time to pray for that ministry. And if you do want any information about it or would like to support it in any way, please don't hesitate to speak to Maureen. I want to highlight the car boot sale chiefly because of a change of date. So the car boot sale will now be held on Sunday the 8th of October from 10 to 12:30, the 8th of October. So please do note that change of date. This is the last Sunday you have an opportunity to vote for your favourite hymn, song, paraphrase or item of Christian music. Because we're hoping that from Sundays that will carry on approaching harvest, and then throughout the season we'll be spending Sunday mornings looking at the significance of the congregation's favourite items of praise. So please do vote today if you haven't had the opportunity. There's a box in the McIntyre suite and a box in the vestibule, and after this evening service we'll be counting the votes to see how things have fallen. So please get your vote in today if you haven't done already, and we'll see which hymns and which items of Christian music we'll be exploring together. The last item I want to mention to you is just our service this evening. If you remember, one of the things that we wanted to do was to reimagine our evening service, and we've done that by providing an opportunity for our choir to lead us in a more kind of reflective, musical focused service. We have had a couple of these services, and we've been very pleased last time around the number of visitors came and enjoyed the opportunity to worship in that more reflective way. So we're doing that again this evening along the theme of rejoice. And I really would encourage you to come this evening at 7 p.m. for that shorter service and for that time of reflection and praise, and maybe invite someone to come along with you. We're very blessed in Craiga to have the choir that we do, and to worship in a way that is different from all of the churches really around us. And these wee services are an opportunity for us to just enjoy that. So please, if you could spread the word about it, that would be much appreciated. So they are all our announcements. And we still our hearts before the Lord in worship once again as we turn to his word. And our first reading today is from John's first letter, 1 John chapter 4, and we'll begin together at verse 7. So we turn together to 1 John chapter 4, beginning at verse 7. And you'll find that on page 1227. Of the Pew Bible, that's 1227. This is the Word of God. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. We know that we live in him, and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment, because in this world we are like him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. If anyone says, "I love God," yet hates his brother, he is a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love God, whom he has not seen. And he has given us this command: whoever loves God must also love his brother. Amen. And we thank God for his word. We come to open God's word again, this time We turn to the Old Testament and to the book of the Psalms, and our reading is Psalm 10, and you'll find that on page 547 in the Pew Bible. We're going to use Psalm 10 as a bit of a template for our intercessory prayer, which we'll have afterwards. Psalm 10, and again, this is God's Word. Why, O Lord, do you stand far off? Why do you hide yourself in times of trouble? In his arrogance, the wicked man hunts down the weak, who are caught in the schemes he devises. He boasts of the cravings of his heart. He blesses the greedy and reviles the Lord. In his pride, the wicked does not seek him. In all his thoughts, there is no room for God. His ways are always prosperous. He is haughty, and your laws are far from him. He sneers at all his enemies. He says to himself, "Nothing will shake me. I'll always be happy and never have trouble." His mouth is full of curses and lies and threats. Trouble and evil are under his tongue. He lies in wait near the villages. From ambush, he murders the innocent, watching in secret for his victims. He lies in wait like a lion in cover. He lies in wait to catch the helpless. He catches the helpless and drags them off in his net. His victims are crushed, they collapse, they fall under his strength. He says to himself, "God has forgotten." He covers his face and never sees. Arise, Lord. Lift up your hand, O God. Do not forget the helpless. Why does the wicked man revile God? Why does he say to himself, "He won't call me to account"? But you, O God, do see trouble and grief. You consider it to take it in hand. The victim commits himself to you. You are the helper of the fatherless. Break the arm of the wicked and evil man. Call him to account for his wickedness. That would not be found out. The Lord is king forever and ever. The nations will perish from his land. You hear, O Lord, the desire of the afflicted. You encourage them and you listen to their cry, defending the fatherless and the oppressed, in order that man who is of the earth may terrify no more. Amen. And once again, we praise God for his word. Let us take a few moments to pray, praying for the world and for the church. And as I say, using this psalm as an opportunity for us to reflect. Let's pray. Sometimes, Father, the words of this psalm seem very real to us. And we cry with the afflicted in the world, "Why do you stand so far off? Where are you in times of trouble?" Because we look at a world and we see that those who know weakness and frailty are often trampled upon by others. Those who desire power for their own ends. We see countries ravaged by the struggle of war. And we have watched how those who would seek to go out and do harm seem to have success, seem to win. We look around, even in our own lives and in our own communities and family circles, and see those who are struggling with burdens and no fears. And we wish that were not so. We wonder sometimes, Father, where you are But yet, this psalmist reminds us that even in the depths of our fears and doubts, you have not forgotten us and have not forsaken us. And this world and all its pretend power, as the psalmist rightly says, will perish. And all those who have built towers of Babel against you, well, Father, those towers will not stand. So we ask you today to remind us that you are the King forever and ever. That you, through your love, would shine that hope into the most hopeless and forgotten of places. And through the specks of light that hope would leave behind, Father, that would touch the most unlikely of people in those most unlikely of places, and that hope would be the song of hearts all around. We pray, Father, for those who know grief and mourning. And while this week we are still very mindful of our King and his family as they mourn the loss of Queen Elizabeth II, we are very mindful that shared experience of grief has lifted in many hearts old feelings of grief. And we pray for those who continue to grieve and ask that your hope would bless and encourage them, that your love would well up within them, and that they would know of your presence. We pray, Lord, for our own church family here in Craigie. And next week, as we come together to dedicate the work of this church to you, we ask, Father, that you would give us fresh heads and open hearts to serve you, and that you would help us with whatever struggles we have in our own lives. And we present those struggles to you now. And yet, as we present our struggles to you, we are mindful of all the things that we can thank you for, all the small things in our lives that give us reason and purpose, our family and friends, the things that we do, the little things that make it all worthwhile. And we thank you, Father, that in the big and in the little and everything in between, we can find your presence and your help. Today, Father, as we have thanked you for Arthur and his family, we pray, Lord, for all the children of this church, all the children who are connected to this church family in whatever way. We worry for them in a world so full of troubles and challenges. But it is such a blessing and it is such a good thing that we as a church family can support them and encourage them as they grow, that they would know more and more of Jesus and make a difference in the world for him. So we pray for all the children of this church, for all the parents and grandparents and aunties and uncles, and all of those who have an opportunity to influence the lives of those little people that are part of our family here. But we pray as we tie these prayers together, that you would help each and every one of us to be a mother and father and brother and sister and auntie and uncle to one another in this place as a family of God. Father, we lift these prayers to you in and through the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Just before we take a brief moment or two to explore God's word together, we're going to stand and sing once again to his praise. And this time we're going to do so with 523, O Love That Wilt Not Let Me Go.
Thank you.
Sunday can be a really busy day, even though it's meant to be a day of rest. It can actually be a day where there's a lot going on. And this is one of those Sundays where we come to church as we normally do to worship and to go through that ritual, if you like, for lack of a better word, that we are used to Sunday by Sunday. But we also come feeling, I believe, a real sense of what's going to happen tomorrow and the funeral of the Queen, and that kind of weird sense that it has given this week, a week that has kind of seemed very short but very long, and almost like that time between Christmas and a New Year where you're never quite sure what day it is and all of that. It's been a strange week, and I think we're still all mindful of that at some level. But we also come together today for a very special purpose that we have already shared in, and that is, of course, to celebrate and to give thanks for baptizing Arthur into our church family here at Craigie, and asking God to bless his family as they would seek to grow in that faith. So it's like all these things going on at once, and as we try to kind of make sense of all of that and put it all neatly together, actually I don't think it's an accident at all. Because what is the thing that kind of holds all this together? We've been looking at these three remain, those things that Paul points out in his letter. We have talked about hope and faith, or faith and hope, and now we find ourselves at love, the last of the three. And it's no accident and coincidence that love is the thing we focus on today, because love is that very thing that binds these three things together. Love is the reason why we ought to come Sunday by Sunday to worship God, because we love the God who first loved us, and we love each other in his name and for his sake. Love is the reason why we are gathered here. There's no other reason. If there's another reason, then we have got it wrong, or we have missed the idea behind it. Love is the reason why grief affects us the way it does. And love is the reason why people have queued for the guts of a day to pay their respects to the Queen. Love and a sense of devotion to one another. And why else would you as a family bring Arthur for me to throw water around him, other than because you love him and you want the best for him and you want him to grow into this faith that you know and love so well yourself? It's love. The Beatles were right. All you need is love. But the problem is, we have such a mixed up idea of what love actually is in the world in which we live. And we mix up love with lust, and we mix up love with a desire for things. We mix up love with a desire for power. We mix up love for like. And we kind of get it all muddled. Today maybe is an opportunity for us in this kind of mess and confusion of a busy Sunday to kind of strip things back and say, Well, what is love? And why does it hold all these things together? In the passages that we read, we found ourselves being instructed by John about the nature of love. Let me read a wee bit to you once again. He says, "Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." Dear friends, since God loved us, we ought to love one another. John says, this is love, that God would send his Son into the world to die for our sins. That is love. Love is that God would give the most precious thing, his only begotten Son, to die for our sins. That he would give of himself for those who are unworthy and undeserving. That love reaches across. That love stretches out. That love does something beyond expectation, beyond merit. That love does something transformational, world-changing. That love is not just the fancy of something that we like, or something that's nice and inoffensive. That love is boundless. That's why Wesley, when he reflected upon the love that God has for us and how John says that is love, Jesus coming to die for us, that's why he said in a hymn that echoes question after question, "And can it be that I should gain an interest in the Saviour's blood? He died for me." Who? Who caused his pain? For me. Who him to death pursued. Amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, would die for me? Amazing love. How can it be that thou, my God, shouldst die for me? That is love. When we come and we realize once again and echo those words in our own heart, why would God do such a thing for me? Why? I have done nothing to warrant it. In fact, as Wesley says, it was to his death that I pursued him too. I nailed him to the cross because of my sin. But yet he would die for me. And that sense of sacrifice and devotion and unwarranted favor and care should do two things. It should break our heart, but it should also fill our heart with such a joy and a wonder that we can do nothing but live in the power of that love. That's what John says. This love was given to you so that you would live in his name. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. That's the idea. That as our hearts break because of our sin and our acknowledgement of this undeserved love, we realize that actually we are God's treasure and his possession that he is presenting to the world so that we would be those who would live for Jesus and have a new identity shaped and fashioned in that love, to be inspired and remade and transformed by that love, to live in it and for it and by it. At my ordination, I chose one of the hymns as that I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. It's one of those hymns that I can remember from when I was a wee boy. I never knew a time when I didn't know it. And the verse, or the chorus, I should say, still brings me to tears because of its simplicity. Oh, how marvelous. Oh, how wonderful. And my song shall ever be. Oh, how marvelous. Oh, how wonderful is my Saviour's love for me. That's what John's saying to us. Oh, how marvelous, oh how wonderful, my song shall ever be. That we are known as those who have been so moved and transformed by the love that God has for us in Christ, by sending him to die for our sins, that that is our song and our reason for living. That must therefore translate itself into how we treat one another. That's the next thing that John goes on to, isn't it? And if we have this love for Christ because of the love he has for us, then we must have a love for one another. Because if it doesn't manifest in a love for one another, then what's the point? If it's a love that we keep locked in our mind and in our heart and don't let it out and don't show it and don't live in it, then what's the point? And that's why he prompts us and leads us and guides us to be those who would, in our busy lives and in our unpredictable circumstances, and when we feel like the psalmist in Psalm 10, all of those things and burdens and chaoses and all the things on our shoulders, we would just stop and we remember that God loves us and that that love inspires us to love each other. to be sacrificial and caring and open, to be those who would want the best for each other, would be those who would point each other to the truth of who Jesus is, and would often in times perhaps have to lead people away from sin in love and in grace for their own protection and welfare, but to be those who would desire more and more for more and more people to know more and more of Jesus. That's why today, as we baptized Arthur, we hope and pray that he would know more and more of Jesus, and that through the work of God in his heart, he would grow up to be a mighty man of God who would lead other people through his witness and his example and his love to know more and more of Jesus, so that that would be their song as well. One of the things that I think as we try to make sense of all that we've talked about this morning and put this together in one place is to remember that God is love, but love is not God. And what I mean by that is that God has given to us a way and a purpose and a reason for living in Jesus Christ. That our love is to be reflected in and through him. And it is through his strength that we can tell the difference between the lust and the desire for power and the desire for stuff and all the things that would get in the way and masquerade as love. It is through his help and his strength that we could see the difference and therefore long to live in that love that he gives. The Christian does not think God will love us because we are good, but that God will make us good because he loves us. Just as the roof of a sun house does not attract the sun because it is bright, but becomes bright because the sun shines on it. C.S. Lewis points us to that idea, that the best way to understand the true nature of love is to be those that reflect Christ, and through reflecting Christ, be those who would long for what he longs for, to be those who would live for his kingdom and to see his kingdom come. I pray today, as I always do, silently and in my own heart, that this would be a place where we would all know Jesus more and more and love him better and better. And I pray today that as we baptized Arthur and as we put that water on his head, that that symbolism would be something that would remind us of the beautiful simplicity of loving Christ. It's one of the hardest things we'll ever do in our lives, but it's also one of the most beautiful and one of the most purposeful and one of the most important. So perhaps today we would be reminded of those things, that we would be reminded of love and living in love and being those who would be shaped and fashioned by it for the kingdom of God. And that would be our song, because it really is marvelous and it really is wonderful, the love of Christ for us. Will we pray? Let's pray. Father, help us today to remember that love is not a feeling that comes and goes. That love is not a list of things that we like or tolerate. But love is an action. Love is an action that you display to us so beautifully and forcefully in sending your Son to die for our sins. Help us, therefore, to see the power of that love. And we ask that it would manifest itself in our lives, and that we would live for it and in it and through it, and that that love would bind us together as a family of believers. And that love would be a help and a stay to those who grieve, and that that love would be our story and our song. for we ask it in Jesus' name. Father, accept these gifts as a demonstration of our desire to serve you, as a token of our thanks for all that you are and all that you have done. And we ask that you would use this offering for the extension of your kingdom near and far, and that you would use us as living sacrifices, those who would seek to live for you. And we ask that in doing that we would know the grace and the help that there is to be found in Jesus. That his grace would be ours. That your love that is steadfast and eternal would be ours. And the fellowship of the Holy Spirit would be ours this day and indeed forevermore.